So welcome to the next foss-north podcast. Today we have Pavel from Synergon here. So Pavel, please tell us a bit about yourself.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for having me. My name is Pavel Kopylov, and I work for a company called Synergon. I'm a lawyer by background. I worked as an in-house lawyer for some years, and then I got a master's degree in industrial engineering from Sharmish, which is a bit surprisingly for a lawyer. Then I work with the education with entrepreneurship education here in Sharmish, and I'm currently working as intellectual property advisor. And what I work most with is intellectual property strategy. And like, this topic is very broad. But traditionally, so we have lots of projects, smaller ones like startups, university projects, even with like 1-2 developers, and we have bigger organizations. And mainly in those projects or companies, they have created some innovation, broadly speaking, yes, and they need to make sure that they have a good control position over this innovation. So meaning that that the competitors will not be able like to copy this innovation and get the same results. So what we normally do is looking into project from very broad perspective and saying, yes, so we have, say you have a digitalized tool for decision making support for surgeons during the operations. So we go in and see, yes, well, you have this some specific algorithms there, you have a database, you have certain contractual relationship or access to certain data or access to certain technology through license agreement. So and you have like scientific methods, and all of those assets, as you can call them, so like things that are valuable and that are important for the project. So all those assets can be protected by some form of intellectual property. So and there are like many. So you talked previously very much on copyright on this podcast, for example, patents. There are trademarks also as a way of protection. There are database protection, trade secrets. So like you as an entrepreneur and as a project owner, you need to choose like what type of protection to choose and what type of protection to prioritize and which assets are more valuable, which assets are less valuable. Because like maybe it's not like in copyright, it's not so much incorporated by the patent, which is considered like to be the strongest protection, but it's very costly. So the problem there is like to find funding for the patent. But yeah, and again, so it builds very much on what you're going to do next with the project. So are you like about to go and talk to the investors? Then you might want to show that I have a patent application, for example, or I have this inventory of assets and I know that it could be protected by copyright and I filed for trademark. Or whether you go on the market, you will release this. And then you maybe you're releasing some part as an open source and some part of free premium features, or like some part of service will be not open source. So yeah, so like it's like basically again it's very broad, but it's what I do. So trying to balance those different types of IP and find a good solution for a specific business.
Yeah, like the word balance is really good, I'd say, because it's to me, it's always a trade-off of what to protect. Because if you choose to protect everything, you have to develop everything. But if you can collaborate around all, let's say, the non-differentiating parts, and probably slightly beyond that, you can sort of reduce your maintenance overhead or your investment in technology, while still protecting what is important.
Yeah, exactly. Especially with the patent, so you have like developed some scientific methods, which is in the background of the innovation. So the patent asset is costly, it also it becomes public. So everyone knows your competitor know that you are investing in this type of technology field. So you really need to okay, this part of the methods will be published and I want to get a patent on this. This part of the method will stay secret because I don't want anyone to invent around this part which is published.
Worked with defensive publishing as well to sort of counter others' potential patents? Because I guess this is a balancing act if you have multiple competitors. So if you cannot afford a patent yourself, maybe you can at least document that this invention exists at this point in time so that nobody else can patent it either.
But there could be different strategies. I mean, if you have the knowledge technology, which is very important for you, and maybe this it adds on functionality to your product, and this functionality is superior compared to other competitors, you may want to have a stronger control on this. So you can publish this, and then everyone will know, and you will destroy the novelty for others, or you can keep it secret. So it will be secret.
It's a balance act, definitely.
So it's like a secret ingredient that you have that adds on this functionality, and secrecy actually is one of the main forms of keeping knowledge control of the knowledge because it stays within the company. The more complex is to manage secrecy when you three people. Working in the same project, it goes well, but when the organization is growing bigger, it becomes even more difficult. And with secrecy, it's not seldom that the situation happened when someone who was in the beginning of the project, some key developer, starts working for a competitor, and you naturally want to to know that you have a good contract with this co-developer from the beginning and you have outlined what is the trade secret and what should not be disclosed to other parties. So secrecy is a good way for protecting, but it's challenging in terms how you keep it secret.
I'm curious here, if you look back and to now, have you seen a shift in strategy when it comes to the companies with their views on, say, copyright, patents, and open source?
Mm-hmm. Naturally, so the project that I work most, and these are within the medicine and e-health mostly, so, and they have very strong research background. So the patent is absolutely the holy grail. But on the other hand, there is also tendency, if it's academic environment, there is also tendency to publish. So it's always play whether we want to publish something before we file the patent application. And said patent is costly and you have to pay for the patent from your own pocket, so you can get funding from the government, for example, to apply for a patent. It's also difficult to get funding from the investor to apply for the patent, so it's very huge upfront payment that you have to do. And when it comes to publishing something, so as Jon mentioned, so it could be destroying the novelty for someone else who wants to patent in this area. So it could be a strategy, but you need to make sure that if you have a method which is built on the software and you want to release the software and publish it, so you may use it, release it as an open source. On the other hand, you want to make sure that you keep you have a right license and people who are using this software know that it comes from you, for example. So, and it's where you think about, okay, I also need a trademark. So the trademark is kind of like the whole umbrella of technologies and people within your project that could be protected. So it like, and again, it's for the whole concept. And copyright here is like, copyright is only, patent protects the technology. Copyright protects only like the things that are written in code, only how they stated. So if you inspire, if you will get inspired by this idea, if you replace the components, so you may not be infringing on copyright.
It's interesting with trademarks, because that's something I spoke, well, prior to Corona, so 1.5 years ago, I spoke in Stockholm about this topic and looked into what's done there. And I, for instance, Arduino, and I think LibreOffice, and also Mozilla uses this. I mean, that's why we had IceWeasel for so long in Debian, because Debian had a slightly different build configuration, so they were not allowed to call it Firefox. Mm-hmm. I also think there was a case, I can look it up and add a link. There was a case of someone selling LibreOffice in the Windows App Store, which they only could stop basically by having the trademark, because that was the infringement. Since the product itself is open source, you can never prevent them from sort of rebuilding and then charging for it.
Exactly. And with those type of licenses, people can use your software. But if they try to use your trademarks, so they could be infringing, or if they, and so also trademarks, it often goes with the domain name. So just the tips, whenever you apply for the trademark, it first registers the domains. Side note. So, they could be infringing on the trademark if they sell the product, because they say that this product comes from you.
A few years ago, I spoke to a guy at FOSDEM from the OpenOffice project. I mean, it's under the Apache Foundation nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked him a bit about the relationship between OpenOffice and LibreOffice, and he wasn't very positive about LibreOffice. He basically said that they talk to us every now and then because they want the name, and because mm-hmm. of the licensing differences, they can pull patches from OpenOffice to LibreOffice, but not the other way around. So he wasn't super happy about that. And that was also, I think, only a trademarking thing, that they wanted the name, but because the code they could already get due to the permissive licensing.
Yeah. You're currently muted, Henrik, by the way.
It happens again. So perhaps projects should wisely consider the implications of the license they're choosing. I've been on this before. Sorry.
And also with the trademark, it builds on value throughout the years. So even if you release this project and then you don't touch it for like 10 years and people start like using the software in their products, and you know it comes like from this specific project, so you still have the trademark, and you can claim that, see, like my project is used in so many other projects, and this is developing the concept of my trademark here.
How does trademarks work from a practical perspective? Do you register per market? So you get like a EU trademark and a US trademark, is it a continuous cost over those 10 years, or do you just get it once and then you have it forever?
Mm-hmm. Trademarks, like patents, are limited to 20 years. Copyright is also limited like to 70 years and after the death of the author, but trademarks are forever in principle. You only have to pay renewal fees. Like it depends, like in Europe, it's 10 years period. And these are not the big money. And when it comes to Europe, yes, there is a unified system for trademark protection. So you can get protection in the entire Europe as a price of one trademark. Then there are some differences, like in USA, Canada, they have like local systems. In Latin America, Australia, so there are different regional legislations. But in Europe, you can apply for like European trademark. And there are some countries, I think Norway is not within this the scope. So if you want to trademark in Norway, so you can, you need to apply separately there. And Switzerland, I guess, also.
What about the UK nowadays?
Don't know exactly right now. And I know the trademark application filed before Brexit, so they still remain in force in the UK. But yeah, again, you can also, like with trademarks, you can go and apply in each specific country, like in only in Sweden or in Hungary or whatever country. But it will be more costly, and the patent offices, trademark offices, national trademark offices, they are more like peculiar about the applications that you submit and the marks you want to protect. Because and by the way, like the trademark is something that needs to be need to be distinctive. So if you have an office application, so you can name it like word processor for Office. So it will be distinctive. It needs to be something that helps customer to distinguish this product from other Office processors.
Yeah, isn't this what is being challenged around Google? That people claim that their trademark has turned into a generic verb, so it should no longer be possible to hold that as a trademark. And then, yeah,
exactly, because yeah, it's correct. So when you have an exclusive right for the trademark, for the symbol, you have the exclusive right to like you. May disallow others use this name, use this this mark. So you basically, when you have the trademark, which is generic, like tables, computers, so you don't allow others to use those terms in like normal life. So and what's happening with Google? So yes, the term became too generic. So you can't like disallow someone to say, I would Google this.
That's interesting. I mean, would that then, so that becomes a problem when you want to renew your trademark, I guess. It's nothing that changes during the 10-year period, but then it can sort of be challenged. And Google being a US company, I guess it goes to court and there's a dispute somewhere.
I guess it may be difficulties in if someone uses this term on their web page and some competitor using this term, you can't really enforce it like and say that they're using my trademark because kind of everyone is using this trademark because it's too generic.
Yeah, but it's only the word, not the logo and the coloring and sort of all the other things around the brand.
Well, I'm not sure about the coloring because this like the palette they use, the colors they use on the Google logotype is also somehow, I think they were consistent with using those colors, so I'm not sure. But yeah, with trademark you can protect the like words, phrases, or you can protect the images, pictures, and sometimes like people want to protect. Like they have an invention and it's like some, I don't know, innovative stand for the computer, and they call it innovative stand, but they put this in this special logo on this and they apply for logotype protection. But then you have problems like when you want to change the logotype, so you basically have to change to apply for a new trademark protection. Because like this protection only covers the image, but not the name itself.
Do you see? I mean, we spoke about Mozilla with Firefox and those things where you sort of restrict other people from distributing things under your name. Are there people using trademarks in the other direction? So that they enforce attribution to their trademark? So everyone has to say that this is from blah, blah, blah. And then they are the only ones who are allowed to use blah, 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 in a certain context, so to speak. Not to prevent the distribution of the software, but to get their brand out, so to speak.
I mean, you mean in kind of in attribution clause?
Exactly.
Because like in Mozilla license, it says that you're not allowed to use the trademarks as long as you don't use this as attribution.
Yeah, exactly. So there is the other direction, so to speak.
Yeah, so and with these terms, you kind of expand the value, so people need to relate to you and mention your brand, and so, which makes you like brand look better.
Are you aware of anyone doing that?
Or not something that can give you a right example to know.
No.
But isn't some open source licenses almost doing similar thing, that you're allowed to sell this and copy it and so on as long as you keep the copyright notice and you say that this is still this software and so on? I mean, of course, if you make derivatives, then maybe that goes out the door. But otherwise, for example, everywhere it says that this software uses curl. And why does it say that? Because you have to say it.
Yeah, okay. And then the only step left is then to trademark curl, if you really want to lock it down, so to speak.
Yeah, there are like other ways like of this. Downloading software on the internet, of course, but
there's one true and right way, and other ways.
Yeah, but it's like with the trademark. So you're stating the facts, and you just like you can use the trademarks in use, for example, when you report on the facts related to the specific product or like company. So yes, but you having this attribution, so you kind of expand the value, and you additionally with the licenses, when you disallow using the trademark, you create additional limits on people. But still even though it doesn't say in the license you're not allowed to use the trademark, they still may be doing infringement if they use. So just additional clause for people like to signal that it's our brand and we are serious about the brand.
And it's an additional aspect, sort of. It's a bit like software patents, that it's you don't see it up front. You need to be aware that the risk exists in that case.
Yeah, exactly. And that's why we talk about the strategy. It creates different levels. So you have a copyright protection and you distribute on the copyright license terms, but still the trademark is yours and you want to keep it. Because like the main value of your business is the trademark.
Yeah. You mentioned you sent a whole list before the this session with different things there. I think there are two things that we haven't touched upon. One is design. Is that sort of trademark protection of a design?
So the design protection is protection of how the product looks like. It's mainly for like physical products, but there were cases, especially with this. Like this kind of interface for several years ago also was protected by design, and it was a battle between Samsung and Apple regarding this. So it could be applicable if you have, I don't know, if you have some specific graphic user interface in your product, which is very different from what others have. So it could be.
So it needs to be very distinct in sort of how it looks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And like when it comes to software products, it's kind of difficult to like claim it's distinctive when you have this button here.
Yeah, exactly. And there are so many variations. The last term that you mentioned here that I don't know is database protection or database grid. I guess I translate it directly.
Yes, yeah,
and it makes it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so database, they're very interesting in terms of intellectual property, how you protect. And in Europe, there is something called catalog, that when you protect the catalogs, and mainly it stems like from yellow pages and like the list of the names there. So what's protected, it's not the individual entries in the database, but the way you put it together, the way it's arranged. So it's for Europe. In other countries, database also can be protected. Again, the arrangement of information can be protected through copyright. If the information is arranged in a specific, like creative manner. So to this end, like for the project that we work with, for example, annotated data is quite so can qualify for this type of protection. So even though you can protect like the exact data points, but you create like the whole database.
But then what does it protect against? Is it like in case somebody tries to reverse engineer the database, or I mean,
it protects against copying of the substantial part of the or the entire database. Mm-hmm. Right. So if you give like if you're developing some AI tool and you have a partner who is doing the annotation work for you, and they annotate the text and give you back the results, and then they are also helping your competitor to do the same thing. And when they use this database that comes from you in their work, so they may be infringing on this type of protection.
I see. Yep.
But that's kind of interesting. From like we spoke about protecting your secret source in a partially open system, and I mean this then turns into the open data perspective on things as opposed to open code. Where, for instance, the city of Gothenburg has kind of an interesting approach where they provide open data, but I don't think they do that much software historically. So that's sort of their strategy, to open up the data to enable the innovation, while in other cases you might want to open up the algorithms but keep the data. I guess that's exactly. Also a fun balancing game for the business model, so to speak.
Yeah, really, and you can... Only when you, if you do like internally, if you have this thinking process and see what like kind of assets, valuable assets they are. So you have a software which is open source, but you have access to specific data. Maybe this data comes from open data projects, but still for someone, for your competitors, they may get the same result if they just take the software as open source and use the data sources. But so you must keep this secret information where the data comes from, for example, like the mere fact that we are using these databases. So, and it could be something that you may keep secret.
Yeah, and open and data in Europe is very interesting to me, because it seems like the EU to some extent has sort of made a stance to actually push for open data in many perspectives.
Yeah, it seems like there is some trend towards this, but I've listened to some other conference about open data. And it was within automotive, and you know, say self-driving cars, and all those databases related to roads and road signs. There is kind of there is an intention. Everyone thinks that it would be good to share this data to like with everyone, so we can build safer cars, better roads, and better. But on the other hand, there is reluctance, and people don't really know how to share the data and what the impact would be if the data is shared publicly.
So, yeah, just data formats and those parts are, of course.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe everybody thinks that their data set is the best one, and if they share it, they lose their competitive edge momentarily before being able to build something better with the collective data.
Exactly.
That sounds exactly. Like a car company to me. So
mm-hmm. I will not comment.
I'm curious here. If we go back a bit to the introduction of yourself, you mentioned that you have an engineering. I can't remember what kind of engineering degree you have.
It's industrial engineering, and it's mainly entrepreneurship.
So you have an engineering and you have a law background. So how useful is that combination for you when, like in practice, when you work?
Well, I'm curious person, I would say. So it works good for me. Like when it comes to legal education and like legal profession, you tend to see risks everywhere. Like it's risks everywhere, like red flags. Having this industrial engineering background, you can see the risks, but you still understand that there could be possibilities or ways around those risks. So you're not getting that, like, I don't know, afraid of doing mistakes or of risks. So for me, it works as a good combination, and especially working with the IP, which is very much intellectually kind of stimulating. So it's a great combination.
From my perspective. Funny you mentioned risk. It's usual when I in my working place, and I've had several discussions with the lawyers I'm currently working with, that I prefer to avoid the word risk, because it's like, especially in combination with free and open source software, because for me it puts the focus on something else rather than the like obvious like benefits from it. So do you have any, mm-hmm. like, you did, I know a good friend of mine, she's a lawyer, and she's responsible. So I understand and I appreciate that the risk assessment is important for you. So what are your views on the wording risk versus benefits?
Well, you always need to make, when you decide which risk is relevant or not, you need to make informed decisions. When it comes like to the open source software, you need to maybe to be able to like kind of manage those known unknowns. So the risk if someone, if I have a GPL license in the code and someone will contact me and ask me why do I have this proprietary license on the component that should be GPL based. So for me, it's kind of, you need to be aware and know the risks, and yes, basically this, and you have either to accept or like to live with it and see what happens. And then if that what happens, because like we discussed it much with the patents, and especially, so the risks of of someone infringing on my patents, for example. So you can have a patent, and if someone infringes, you have the right to claim damages and let those people stop their production or whatever. But in terms of economic perspective, it's rather, again, it's a costly process to prove this. So if you're a small company, you might be lacking like financial support for enforcing your intellectual property. And probably you heard lately it was the bank ID, like the patents related to bank ID. So like a consulting company helping big banks to build their like internal systems, and they also, the consultant had a patent and trade secret protection. But still the banks were stronger in terms of like how much they are able to pay to the lawyers. So even though you might be right, or like presumably right, you need to have the muscles to be able to enforce this. And like for smaller project, it's difficult, I think.
It's but like the reversal of a patent troll, basically.
What do you mean?
Like if you're subjected to a patent troll, then the costly part is proving that you are not infringing. And what you're describing is that if someone actually infringes on your stuff, then the costly part is to prove that they are, or just to go to court at all.
Yeah, it's basically like the court who has to decide. So not you, not the other infringing party can determine whether it's infringement or not. Maybe it's somewhere close. It's only the court who determines, and who wins in the court, it's another like aspect to this. And like is it someone who can like get a better lawyer, or
yeah, like so there, I think it's pans out over different countries as well. So I guess in Sweden, you always pay the other party's fees if you lose. But while I think in Germany, there's a cap to it. So you don't, I mean, if your counterparty, the bank, choose to hire more expensive lawyers, it's sort of on their bill as soon as they hit this sort of, what do you say, template cost, so to speak.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess in the US, the sky's the limit as well. So, and sometimes you don't really get to pick where you are sued. So.
Mm. Exactly. And at the same time, when you have to pay the legal costs, you have your production, you have to employ new people to build the product, and it comes at the same time. So yeah, difficult to like maintain this.
Yeah, definitely.
That leads to the old debate about patents in software. Who does it protect? For me, it's hard to see how it protects the smaller innovators, which, correct me if I'm wrong, which patents are supposed to, like, it was invented to protect the little guy or woman.
Yeah, and but like, I also helped some private inventors, like the guys who do things in their garage. Kind of, and they really made good things, and things having potential. And they say, yeah, this is the paper, like it's the most expensive paper in my life, like the patent certificate. And still they had problems, like, because the patent doesn't give you like sales directly. It's only the certificate. So, and when you start talking to the customers, potential partners, you show them the invention. And it happened to some people when they demonstrate the invention, and then unexpectedly the bigger partner got inspired of this invention and then created something new. But it's, maybe it could be infringing, but yeah, if you're faced with like multinational corporation, yeah, you are not in good negotiation position to discuss this.
And I mean, even the big ones have their patent pools and things like this to provide the non-differentiating part. I'd like to mention this Open Innovation Network as one thing, if you're building something around Linux-based system. Mm-hmm. they sort of make Linux non-differentiating and gather patents, and they have all the big ones in there, so it basically makes that into a sort of no man's land. So there's no fighting over that. Instead, you build something around it, and there you can do what you like, so to speak.
Yeah, exactly. So you're building the infrastructure for sharing the patented knowledge on a kind of like open source, the same. If you accept the rules of the game, so you're allowed to use this technology.
How did you get like engaged, involved in like the open source free software part of the legal business?
Well, we were doing a project for a bigger client who had some compliance issues and issues with using this software composition analysis tools for the software they are using. And it was like, for me, it was a good, I didn't expect there is such a welcoming community and supporting community. It was like my first impression, like, wow, people support each other, people want to talk to each other, and they're not like taking like paid, because yeah, it's only my opinion, but it's a bit different like in patent and legal domains, when people get paid by hour, and each like hour cost may cost something. So here it's like open source is very different in this respect. It's like only my like view on this.
But I when it comes to open source and open data, it's, and also defensive patent publications, it feels like it's a yin and yang thing in all of this. And your job is sort of to balance the two. So what part of the software needs to be protected? What is best open? What part of the data or the sort of knowledge assets? And also, what when it comes to patents, do we do the patent thing, which is expensive, or do we simply do the publication thing, which doesn't cost anything, but it also blocks the patenting for all parties, including yourself, of course.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like the basic is to always do the homework of understanding which assets and like critical pieces of knowledge that there are in the project, and then which pieces are more critical. So what like in terms of like my competitive advantage, so what is this that brings this superiority to my product compared to the client? So maybe some specific functionality or the algorithms that I use or access to data. So you normally will like have stronger protection on the assets that are more critical than others. And some assets, like with the open source, with the software, you can use as kind of somewhat branding perspective, but also from like development perspectives as well, because like when other people contribute to your software and it becomes better, why not let them do it under specific terms and keeping your right to the trademarks for this.
Yeah, and I mean, another thing that I come to think of that's close by is this KDQ, Free QT Foundation, I think it's called. Which is sort of almost a defensive contract around a dual licensed platform. So, I mean, Qt is a bit special that it's open source, but there is a copyright holder in the Qt company that also has the right to sell it commercially. And they have this contract that if they stop contributing to the open source or if they go bankrupt, the open source parts go from a strong copyleft, so GPLv3, to basically BSD, I think. So it's a very permissive license automatically. And I mean, that could be of interest for the open source community, of course, in collaborating with a commercial entity, but also as a customer, since Qt is a framework that you build your product on, that sort of decouples you through this open sourcing from them as an entity. So even if they go bankrupt, you know that your investment is still with you.
Interesting. What do you think? Because you asked several times about open data, you mentioned open data. And from my perspective, when I see that, like open source for the software is kind of established field, and there are like established set of standard licenses, there are standard compliance processes. You maybe heard about open chain. Yeah, this kind of problem. So there are like standards and which are accepted. When it comes to open data, it seems like in comparison to the open source, it's in infancy stage, because like there are not many licenses that could be used for the data. Like people use Creative Commons sometimes, so I think IBM has some certain license, but it's still it feels like it's not developed yet. Or what's your thoughts on this?
I think so too. I mean, it's we've spoken to the city of Gothenburg outside of this podcast, but still, and there seems to be standardization efforts going on for sort of public open data. It's definitely time for a public money, public data campaign to pair with the public money, public code one. But there seems to be standardization going on there in how sort of a city or a region exposes their data and how to encode it. But as you say, it's I don't know personally of like the four freedoms or the open data definition as we have on the open source side. So it's an interesting area. I think it's from a democracy perspective, I personally think that's even more important than the open code to some extent, that you have transparency and insight into the information so that you can form an opinion.
Yeah, true. And like when it comes to commercial data as well, because like again, you can protect the facts, but you can protect like the way you organize the facts. And I've seen there was some court cases when just using of annotated data was kind of breach of copyrights for the databases. So because like, yeah, it's a new gold data, but there is still not system for managing how you enforce those rights.
Yeah, and I mean, isn't it when you use Google Earth that you always see the data sources in like the lower right corner and thing? I mean, it looks like a very complex field in general, because there are so many various sources that you can mix and merge under different licenses, basically, if it's only attribution or if it affects the whole data set. From a software perspective, what is data? What is compilation, or sort of how do you derive something out of data? What's a derived work, so to speak? And how would you address that? So it's, if I had more free time, that would have been a fun thing to do something about.
Yeah, right.
No, but I think it's a huge field, definitely. And it seems, from what I gather, at least, it's being standardized on an EU level, at least from the public sector. And then I guess the private sector hasn't really gotten into this sharing data on that scale. Or they don't have that clear driver at the moment. But as you mentioned, data sets for self-driving cars and so on, there are lots of data that might make sense to share. But I think what I've seen, at least, seems to be more public sector.
Mm. Yeah, but perhaps people don't know what conditions to share the data on. Kind of, we don't have like standards and, okay, how will we share? What happens if this data leads to the products which are like not good for the society, and who takes responsibility for those projects?
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. I mean, that's one of the, what I find really interesting with the open source definition is that you don't discriminate for the purpose. So you make no ethical sort of, you don't try to guide ethically. You can build weapons or you can build hospital equipment. It doesn't matter. If you block either, it's no longer open source.
Aha, uh-huh. By definition.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not sure which one was it. There was a license said that you couldn't use it for evil.
Yeah, it's the JS Lint, I think.
Yeah, and there was a story
about JSON Lint.
Wasn't there a company getting it?
Yeah, it was. Yeah. No. Yeah,
IBM got a license that they could use it for evil.
So they are allowed.
Wasn't it all JSON? But never mind.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. But somebody had sort of got the exception so they can actually use it for evil if they want to. And I guess to fulfill the open source definition.
When you're doing compliance, you sometimes stumble upon really crazy phrases in the source code. Perhaps we should do an episode just about what I've gathered over the years. Comments about specific persons not being allowed to use this and that. And I think it's time to round this off because we're running out of time. I just want to state that we mentioned the KDE and Qt thing before. Cornelius Schumacher gave a good speech about this at FOSDEM. I will provide a link so the listeners, viewers can watch that or listen to it afterwards as well. So a big thanks to you, Pavel, for being here.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.